Hello again, everyone, and welcome to the video. So today it's a lot of information, just to let you know that first of all, it is a lot of information, but you don't have to know it all. So the bones can get very complex. This is a survey course, so I don't make you know it all. So what we're going to be going over today is we're going to, one, just compare the regions of the skeletal system, axial and appendicular, and what kind of bones we find in each. And then we're going to go look through all the major bones. Now, on all these major bones, you're going to see a lot of other lines on these bones. We're not going to worry about those too much. So we talked about bone markings. Bone markings give the structural characteristics to a bone, such as a trochanter, a crest, spine, process, foramen, all those fun words we learned earlier. They are important. We're just not going to name every single one we're talking about today. So, all right, let's hop into this. So first here, we're going to look at axial versus appendicular. What we mean by this, by axial forms the main axis of our body. It's our main support system, because it keeps us all together. So for this one here, of course, we have, you know, for axial, it's all the bone colored parts here. So we got the skull, you know, the vertebral column, and then the thoracic cage. So that's all the axial system. You can see that back here as well, going all the way down to the tailbone or the coccyx. So that's all the axial scale system. Now, the appendicular are the appendages. Now, where some people get mixed up with what is axial and what is appendicular is when it comes to the girdles. When I say the girdles, I mean the pectoral girdle or your shoulder or your pelvic girdle or your hip. Those are, if you see in this, they are green, meaning they are part of the appendicular. So don't let that screw you up there, that they are not part of the axial, they are part of the appendicular. So the two bones that people usually screw up when it comes to axial versus appendicular are the scapula, which is your shoulder blade back here, or your clavicle, which is your collarbone right here. So those two are part of the appendicular. And then same thing here, going down the thoracic cage, you have the sternum. The sternum is, or your breastbone, is also part of the axial. So what we're going to do now, so that was just showing the difference between appendicular and axial. So your appendages are what do all the dancing, and your spinal column is what supports the dancing parts. Now we're going to go through some of these. So up here, this one nicely calls the skull the cranial portion and the facial portion. Well, there's a lot more bones in the skull. So, the body itself has 206 named bones, typically. Sometimes it can be plus or minus in some individuals. But in a trivia question, if you're ever doing a trivia game, 206 is the answer that you want. I'll write that. Oops. 206. That's the key one there. All right, axial. So we're just looking at the skull here first. And as you can see, I'll zoom in on this just a little bit more here. A lot of bones. Every different color here is a bone. So I'm just going to say them quick just so you can hear the names. We've got the frontal bones on the front of the skull. It's where your forehead is. You have some markings in there like the supraorbital foramen. Remember, a foramen is a passageway for blood vessels. Oh, I think that's just a shadow. It's right there. Blood vessels and nerves. No, that is it. Blood vessels and nerves. And then you have other bones. So I'm just going to focus on the bones of the skull first rather than the facial bone. So down here, we have a side profile of the skull. Again, here's the frontal bone again. And then here's a parietal bone. So there are two parietal bones. And so parietal means to form the walls of. Skull bones are all held together by these joints called sutures, which we're going to talk about in the next section. So those are fibrous joints and they're immovable joints. So that's when you can't really push your finger in or move your skull bones around. You're moving muscles when moving your face around. So two parietal bones, You got your frontal bone over here. This is the temporal bone. So right here is your ear canal or external acoustic meatus. Remember, a meatus is a canal-like channel. On the back of your skull, you have your occipital bone. Occipital bone then comes down and around, and that's where you form the articulation with the first vertebrae called the atlas vertebrae. And that allows your head to go like this. When you go like this, you're using your C2 vertebrae, known as your axis. And then there are two other bones found in the cranial cavity here. There's one here that goes inside called the sphenoid. And then there's one deeper in here that forms the superior part of your nasal cavity called your ethmoid bone. Your olfactory neurons or your smell neurons travel up through that bone. And that's how the sense of smell gets to your brain and travels back to the olfactory track. You also have a lot of sinuses in this region. So if you ever had a sinus infection, you know the significance of that feeling as well. And then along with the skull, you know, I could do two videos on the skull. You also have all the facial bones on the skull. The only bone here that's not directly articulated with any other bone is the mandible. I mean, directly sutured is what I mean. It does articulate via a joint, but called your temporomandibular joint right here, or your TMJ, but it does not suture with any other. All the other bones of the skull are immovable and they're fused. Now, so that's the mandible or the jawbone. And then you have your maxilla. So there are two. There's a suture right here. You can't really see in this image. So there's two maxilla or maxillae for plural on each side right here. And those are forming the top part of your, or the superior and anterior part of your hard palate. There's some deeper bones in there, such as your palatine bone, which forms the posterior part of your hard palate. And then there are some processes on the sphenoid, which play a role back there too. But that's getting too deep into it. And then we come around here, you have your cheekbone. Your cheekbone is called your zygomatic bone. So you have two zygomatic bones right there. And then up here, you have your nasal bones, this is a little suture right there. So you have two little nasal bones. Those are the ones that break if you break your nose. Right here, there's a little bone called the lacrimal bone. That one gets its name because you have a gland up here called the lacrimal gland, which releases tears, which drain down over. And there's a little canal in here, which then allows tears to drain down into your nasal cavity, which sometimes is why your nose runs when you're crying. And you get the sniffles. And then here you can also see in purple, the ethmoid bone is found in the eye orbit there too. Oops, I didn't mean to draw a square like that. But yeah, so, and then back here you can also see the sphenoid. And in the back of the eye orbit, you have this superior and inferior fissure, orbital fissure, passageway for blood vessels and nerves. And right here is the optic nerve. Deep in the nose here, you have a bone called the vomer. And then there is a, you're called your nasal concha or conchae. And what these, concha shells, they got shells, they're like ridges in there. So the inferior ones are separate bones themselves, so they could be considered them as well. So, a lot of bones I said right there, right? Don't worry about every single one of them. We might only ever ask about any of the major ones that are obvious. And here you could see a side profile of some of these structures. All right, continuing down through, we of course have the vertebral column. You have three regions. You have your cervical region, you have your thoracic region, and then you have your lumbar region, and then sacrum and coccyx here. So cervical region, you have 7 vertebrae. You eat breakfast at 7 a.m. Thoracic region, you have 12. You eat lunch at noon. And lumbar region, you have 5. You eat dinner at 5. So that's how I remember them down. And then they're, of course, labeled. So C1 through C7, T1 through T12, L1 through L5. All of these are separated by little discs called intervertebral disc. You might have heard of a disc herniation. That's where the disc pushes out and puts pressure onto the nerves in that region and causes a lot of pain. And then, of course, at the end, you have what's called the sacrum, which is some fused vertebrae that come together down to the coccyx, which is then the rudimentary tailbone down there. No main significance for that anymore, of course. And then the coccyx will end up fusing with the iliac crests on the hip bones right there. You can see the spine also has different curvatures. It's got a concave curvature here for your cervical vertebrae, and your cervical vertebrae also more highly mobile. You got convex for your thoracic and concave for the lumbar again. Your thoracic are what ribs also attach to, so you would have all the ribs coming out from the thoracic vertebrae, which when those ribs come out, you have 12 thoracic vertebrae. You also have 12 ribs. So ribs 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 are known as your true ribs because they directly come in and articulate with the sternum via what's called costal cartilage. So costal cartilage is hyaline cartilage. And then 8, 9, and 10, they connect into one and then come in and fuse in. So they're considered false ribs. As well as 11 and 12. These ones aren't connected at all. These ones are called floating ribs. However, they're protecting an important organ back there called the kidney. So they all then come in and connect to the body of the sternum. The sternum also has this piece down here called the xiphoid process, a little point coming down. And then up here is the manubrium. And there's a little notch right there called the jugular notch. And then your clavicles or your collarbones come in right there. So you can feel a little indent. That's your jugular notch of your manubrium. And you can say, well, yeah, the sternum was larger over here to the left. Forgot that image was there. So that is all axial. Now appendicular, I'm just gonna pretty much go through these one by one just to name the bones. We of course have the clavicle here. This is your collarbone, and then you have your scapula back here, which is we generally know it as the shoulder blade. We're not going to go too much more crazy detail into it. And there's what the clavicle looks like. It has this little S shape to it. And then going down the arm, then next bone is called the humerus. Notice the spelling. It's not spelled the same way as funny. A little slight difference there. And then so the humerus, long bone, has a ball and socket for the head. We'll talk about the joints later. So multi-axial movement and whatnot. But so only one bone in the arm right here. Then we get down to the forearm. Forearm has two bones in it. Of course, you have the radius. And then you have the ulna. So the radius is always on the thumb side, and the ulna is always on the pinky side. Or in anatomical position, radius is lateral, ulna is medial. Remember your terms. And then there is a membrane that holds the two together called the interosseous membrane. Here is where you'd form your elbow joint, so ulna locks into that to form the elbow joint. And then the radius allows you to rotate like this. This rotation here is called pronation. And then down here is where you form the socket then for your wrist. So here is then the bones of your wrist. So you have your carpals. Don't worry, we won't name them all, but they all have a different name in there. So you have all your little carpals, and then you have your metacarpals. And then you have your phalanges, which are your fingers. So here you would have your phalanges, metacarpals, and then right in here would be your carpals doing all that sliding action. And then down to the hip. The hip is actually made up of three bones fused together, which are not labeled on this, but there's the ilium, there's the pubis, right here on this side. Then back here is then the ischium. So technically, you can kind of see it, ischial tuberosity. No pubic area, pubic is labeled right there. But you don't have to worry about the names of it. It's just a hip bone. It's got the two wings coming out, and it forms a joint with that sacroiliac joint right there where the sacrum and the hip come together. And then, you know, hips do various one way. They can figure out male versus female. If they discover a pile of bones, they can look at the hip. Females have a wider hip. Males have a more narrow hip. And so here, this pelvic brim and pubic arch can all vary between the two. Alrighty, and then moving down, we have everyone's favorite bone, the largest bone in the body. It's the femur. Very large head on the femur here. Got the neck of the femur coming down the length of the femur, and then forming the knee, the upper part of the knee right here. Two unique markings on the femur, the greater and lesser trochanters, very large muscle attachment sites there. And then we move down to the tibia and the fibula. So here, tibia is your shin bone, as you might know it. So here, the anterior border is technically what you know as your shin here on the tibia. The tibia does all the articulating with the femur. No weight is transferred to the fibula. The fibula is a little bone just off to the side, forms a joint there with the tibia, and then also down here with the tibia. And then this is just a supportive bone in your leg. All weight is transferred down from the femur to the tibia right here. And of course, in your knee joint, you have the femur right there, and then you have your ACL, your PCL, your collateral ligaments, and all that other support in that joint there. And then you have your patella and your ligaments for the patella on the front as well. So tibia is the larger bone in the lower leg. Fibula is the smaller bone. Fibula has an L in it. It is on the lateral side, so towards the outside. Tibia is more towards the midline. Then at the bottom, the little bumps you feel on your ankle are called your malleoli, or a singular lateral or medial malleolus. They're found on the sides of these bones, and they form the pocket then that comes down and forms your foot. Well, they don't form your foot. They hold your foot there with the talus. The talus, all the weight is transferred to the talus right here. So you got to imagine that structure right here going right here over that talus. Then allows your ankle to go like that and whatnot. That's what it's moving in. I guess it kind of shows it right there too. Same thing with the hand. You have your tarsals. Instead of carpals, you have tarsals, metatarsals, and phalanges. Two of the more tarsals here I do talk about, such as the talus, which is the one that directly connects to or articulates with the tibia and the fibula. And then you have your calcaneus, your big heel bone here. It links with your calcaneal tendon, known as, some people know it as your Achilles tendon, then up to your gastrocnemius muscle. And then you have the plantar region of your foot where you have your arch. So the couple different arches you support on your foot, and that helps add a little spring to your walk and support your body weight. The other tarsals are called the cuboid, the navicular, and then these ones are the medial, intermediate, and lateral cuneiforms. So over that, not too bad. And then of course your metatarsals and your phalanges. All toes have three phalanges, except the thumb and big toe only have a proximal and a distal. Okay, that was as fast as I could ever go through the entire skeletal system. I'm sorry, it was still close to 20 minutes, but that was literally as fast as I could do that. Any slower? I mean, I already took a lot out. But yeah, you don't have to know everything. But I just wanted to give you a solid overview of the system, and I hope I did. If you have any questions or you do want longer, better videos, I have a video for every single bone if you want one. Reach out to me and let me know. But if not, hope you have a great rest of your day, and bye-bye.